Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Welcome back to week three of the military-industrial complex. Today is about NSA 47, or National Security Act 1947. How the United States, with the post-World War, what you call World War II, the post-era, was getting ready to square off with the Soviet Union and to refashion the American military establishment to pursue this objective. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to focus on basically one aspect here. Now, what I did was in that handout, I mean, the cover sheet looks the same as it's been for the last 2 weeks. However, what I did was I photocopied 8-9 pages out of a book I've written about National Security Act 1947. And what I did was here, it gives you an idea of how the United States military establishment was refashioned with NSA 47. And I'm going to go into a little bit of the politics that surrounds this. Of course, when you read this thing, if you want to read this thing, you'll notice there's nothing really mentioned here about the National Security Council or the Central Intelligence Agency. That I'm going to add for you here verbally. So if you want to write on these things, you go right ahead. But I want to focus on one aspect of this first, a new technology that came out at the turn of the 20th century. People have been experimenting with it for quite a long time. And it's also changed us in the civilian world. Travel, communications, obviously the military changes are just mind-boggling. And that's aviation. Amounts to a lot here in this National Security Act 1947. Not just materially, I'm talking equipment, and also the services themselves, but the political fallout here between these services. And I'm going to get into how, or because of, scant budget dollars. You know, the World War II's over. And so what happens? Congress gets pretty tight-fisted with the money here. So now there's the scramble among these services for scant budget dollars, and it kind of inflames some of the competition between these services. And we'll get to that. But I think it's important that we understand here this evolution of aviation technology, because it has changed everything, as did the atomic bomb. I mean, make that up with aviation technology. It's extraordinary. And so, you go back to the Wrights, okay, or Gustav Whitehead, if there's any supporters of him here. But let's understand this, that, this is a fledgling technology. And yet, in 10 years, you're going to see, and I mentioned this gentleman before, Mr. Giulio Gavotti, who drops bombs on the Turks during the Turkish-Italian War, November 1, 1911. And now we're off and running. No longer is the airplane going to be used for just observation purposes. We're now seeing it as a weapon of war, a bona fide weapon of war, dropping bombs on people. And when you go back to the Hague Accords of 1899 to 1901, in the Hague Accords is interesting. They didn't want you to bomb people from balloons. They understood this at that point. I often found it fascinating that during the Mexican-American War, there was a fortress called San Juan de Lua. And this is as American forces are trying to break into Veracruz. And John LaMountain, a noted aeronaut of the period, this is like 1845, 1846. He offered the War Department, well, I can have it, because they can't get through this 128-gun fortress. It's a big stone thing. And he offers to make a balloon that will weigh 20,000 pounds, float over the fort, and it had 18,000 pounds of explosives, and then just cut it, and then the War Department didn't want to indulge itself in such Jules Verne fantasies. And they said no. But you see some people beginning to think here, this idea, well, why don't we use the air? And so when you get to the First Civil War, the United States Army Balloon Corps Thaddeus Lowe leading this, and this is for aerial observation. They're not going to bomb people. But then they get into artillery spotting. So now instead of just regular observation, you are now seeing air power now get other tasks. The direction of artillery fire being one of them. And so this new technology, they're going to find other uses for it. You get to the First World War, again, the airplane. Keep in mind what really accentuates the development of the airplane here, a lot of the development of the airplane, the trenches. They're stuck. There's no movement. In the First World War, they're stuck. Interesting, in 1917, I was telling this to my World War I class last week when we did the year 1917. And if you look at the trench line, there's 2.5 million Germans versus 4 million British and French and other Allied troops, 1917. And nobody's going anyplace. So what did the Germans do? They withdrew 30 to 35 miles east to shorten the trench line. This allowed them to take 13 divisions out and put them in reserve. This is it fascinating about this? This 30 or 35 mile withdrawal was the largest change in territory in going on the fourth year of war. That's how these guys were stuck. It was a withdrawal. Gaining, exchange of territory and a withdrawal, not in an offensive. Interesting how they're stuck. So now you're getting these airmen, some of these airmen like Julio Douay, Sir Hugh Boom Trenchard. Well, instead of, you know, why don't, instead of bombing just the trenches, why don't we take war to the enemy's capability to wage war? We'll bomb his factories, the rolling stock, the tracks, the port dock facilities. How about firebombing the farms and burning out the food? This is where we're going here. And you're going to see the British, right, are going to be bombed by what? The Zeppelins? Remember the German Zeppelins, as some people call them, the sausages. I mean, they don't go that fast, but you can go fairly high up until the British start sending fighter planes up to altitude, and then they're beginning to shoot down the Zeppelins. But this is what man's doing with his technology. What happened to the idea, according to the Hague Convention of 1899-1901, you can't bomb people, you shouldn't bomb people from the balloon. What are the Germans doing? End of 1914 going into 1915. Now the damage wrought here is minimal. Minimal. Maybe a few people killed, some buildings destroyed, and obviously here is you don't have a Norden or Sperry bomb site at this point. So you know, these bombs are just, for the most part, falling haphazardly. And some coastal towns in Britain get bombed. Well, London's going to get bombed too, but Portsmouth, Southampton, places like this. And so, but you're seeing the future being cast. The British more or less go with aircraft, or heavier than aircraft as they're known in the day. And they begin to put together it's the Royal Flying Corps. It's not going to be the Royal Air Force until April 1, 1918. April Fool's Day. And you see the British now beginning to bomb. And it's interesting because they have bases forward in France. So they can bomb the western side of Germany. Now Germany's tasting total war. Again, the rudiments of it. But people like Julio Douay, Sir Hugh Boom Trenchard, who the United States Air Force considers a godfather of strategic bombing, let's take it to them. So war now, total war is branching out. It's no longer being fought on the ground. Submarines, right? What's happening to the war at sea? Exclusive use of the submarine. And the Germans are using it for what? Unrestricted submarine warfare to attack the commerce lanes, the convoy or the shipping lanes, to starve the British. Why? Because the British Navy has successfully closeted up most of the German surface fleet for the war, blockading the North Sea and the Channel exits. They can't get into the Atlantic. So the Germans are going to do what they think they have to do, unrestricted submarine warfare. So you see technology taking over here. And the submarine's going to figure prominently later on because aren't there atomic missiles on submarines today? Yeah. Yeah. That weapon evolves. but sticking air power. So you see them beginning to fashion the airplane for offensive purposes, no longer just for observation, no longer to adjust artillery fire. And the fighter plane, you know, the fighter plane pilots in World War I are the darlings of even school children. Manfred von Richthofen, the Red Baron, Werner Voss, Georges Nungesse of France. How about Eddie Rickenbacker? I mean, these are the knights of the air. And they're aerial jousts with each other. Yeah, they used to have challenges. But even they're going to be overcome. These knights of the air are going to be overcome by technology. The bomber, more sophisticated aircraft, no longer is the lone wolf acceptable. Now there's fighter tactics. You have to have a wingman to protect your backside so someone doesn't get on your tail. You see what's happening here? It's becoming more sophisticated, as is the bomber. And you're beginning to get this, and Billy Mitchell's going to latch on to this. The bomber is the way to take war to an enemy's homeland. The fighter plane is a defensive arm. Of course, the fighter plane is sexy. The bombers aren't. You know, that's the difference, the basic difference here. But again, and you're seeing here a movement afoot, especially in this country. Although it will take hold in other countries, Britain being another one. That maybe, just maybe, we ought to take air power away from the Army and make it a standalone service. Well, the Army isn't ready to give up airplanes yet. They look at it as having aircraft support the foot slogger or the soldier. These other airmen see it differently. Sure, we can help the ground pounder, but what about delivering ordnance against an enemy's capability to wage war so we're not stuck in the trenches? And that idea is going to resonate here. Sophistication. Isn't that what happens here? Evolution, technology, and now mate aviation with the Industrial Revolution? Boy, what's coming down the road boggles the mind here. But when the war is over with, you see here what? Budget cuts, right? Yeah. And so this new thing called aviation, or military aviation, And the poster child expression here is England. Again, Sir Hugh Boom Trenchard is afraid, after having built this Royal Air Force, that he's going to lose it with budget cuts. Doesn't Britain have an empire? Mm-hmm. Don't they need to protect that empire? Yeah, well, after losing 965,000 dead soldiers in 4 years, that doesn't count the wounded yet, many of the people want them home. Well, they have to maintain an empire. Means you're going to have troops in Somaliland, Iraq, colonial India, so on and so forth. Maybe not as many troops as you think. Trenchard says, why don't we use the airplane to keep colonial peoples in line? And this will bring up another terminology that you see when you talk about air power. Air policing. Or air control. Air policing is what the United States Air Force was calling it, if you read some of their reports. Air policing. Sounds like a benign term, doesn't it? Yeah, it does. Or air control. I like to call it the constabulary use of air power. That's what it is. And Trenchard convinces the British government here. Well, why don't we use the airplane to keep these people on land? That's exactly what they're going to do. The French are going to latch on to this. What do you think they're doing in their colonies? They were both doing it during the First World War. And so they are going to use the airplane. And these people who live in these villages or in the outback, these indigenous types, they've never been bombed before. They don't know. They don't have RPGs to shoot back. They don't have machine guns to shoot back as of yet, or very few. And so, whenever they get a group of villagers rising up, you bomb them, you keep them in line. It works for a short period of time. This works. Interesting how this is, even to the use in Iraq in 1921 of using poison gas to keep these people in line. Now, if you're appalled at that, keep in mind, poison gas, you're coming out of the First World War, still considered a conventional weapon. You don't have the Geneva Protocols of 1925 yet. You don't have that yet. And so they're going to use poison gas. So Saddam is not the first to use poison gas on Iraqis. The British beat him by quite a number of decades. So when you fast forward ahead to 1935, when the Italian Air Force, Mussolini's Air Force, bombs the Abyssinians or Ethiopians with chlorine, phosgene, and mustard gas, yes, he was violating the 1925 Geneva Protocols, but the British were not. So I suppose there's a legal sticking point here. But by this time, this works. The United States is going to grasp this concept. The Marine Corps in Nicaragua, 1928 to 1932-33, the Marine Corps will experiment with using aircraft in a dive bombing fashion to bomb the Sandinistas, or Somoza's men, the guerrillas looking to throw us out of here. And so the United States Marine Corps begins to experiment here. And they like what they see. The potential is here. So it's interesting what you see develop here. But when you go into the 1930s, keep in mind here, you know, from the 1920s, the United States Army still maintains its grip on air power in this country. I don't want to give it up. But on the Air Corps Tactical School in the 1920s, in 1926, what was known as the Air Service now becomes the United States Army Air Corps. And that name will last until 1941, where it becomes the United States Army Air Forces. But you see in this progression of names, Air Service, Army Air Corps, United States Army Air Forces, it's in the name. Slowly the air power in the Army is going to gain autonomy here. You see it in the name, it's the terminology. Like police action in Korea? That was a war. Ask some of the guys who fought there. It's a war. Police action. I think it makes it sound benign. It's just a police action. No, it's not. Not when you got millions of men involved. I mean, the communists alone are going to lose anywhere from a million to 1.5 million dead. This is a police action? I don't think so. But you see here by the 1930s, and what's fascinating about the Air Corps Tactical School, some of these air instructors are teaching strategic bombing concepts at the expense of fighter tactics. One of those who maintains fighter tactics is Mr. Claire Chennault. How many people know that name? Yeah, what would he later do?
Flying Tigers.
The Flying Tigers, right. He believed, you know, and he was against twin engine fighters. No, he said the fighter is a single engine plane, highly maneuverable, carries heavy armament, right? And is speedy. He was against double engine fighter planes with two, three men in them. He said, that's not a fighter plane. Now you're making a medium, a fighter plane to a medium bomber. And he is going to be on the outs with some of these bomber people. And like a few gentlemen were saying here, yes, he's going to go to China. And he's going to be in charge of the American Volunteer Group, or the Flying Tigers. And he's going to prove a lot of his fighter tactics in China and Burma against the Japanese. But the bomber is gaining credence here. Stanley Baldwin, a British prime minister, will later say, the bomber will always get through. You know, there's this growing belief here in death from the air. In fact, how many people have ever seen that movie, Things to Come, with Raymond Massey? That's an interesting movie to see, 1935. And the gist of it is, the world gets involved in war, and who are the victorious powers? The ones that have the airplane. Bombing people or dropping paratroopers. Interesting, 1935. So you even see it in the movies here. This idea of this evolving technology. But America still has the United States Army in control of air power. When Mr. Roosevelt takes office in 1933, he had been Under Secretary of the Navy. Airmen were a little disconcerted. They go into his office, and he has pictures of ships all over the place. No airplanes, ships all over the place. Kind of gives them an idea, well, we know where we are on the totem pole.
but you know, events are gonna speed up here.
If you go, 1935, again, Italy, you know, invades Ethiopia. Air power has a decisive use for the Italians, even to the point of using poison gas, as I mentioned earlier. 1937,
the Japanese invade China proper. They had already taken Manchuria in September 1931. And they're bombing Canton, Shanghai, so on and so forth.
They're bombing the cities, like Julio Douay says you should. So now they're not only bombing factories and railheads, they're bombing the cities. Spanish Civil War, Italy.
Fascist Italy and Nazi Germany will help Mr. Franco. And they're gonna send the Condor, the Germans will send the Condor Legion.
These are German airmen in this fledgling Luftwaffe who will show what they can do in Spain leading into World War II. One of those who went there is Adolf Galland,
who will later shoot down some 104 Allied planes in World War II. Will be a general of the German fighter forces defending Germany at age 29,
who will fly a Messerschmitt 109 early in the war. And he was a fan of Mickey Mouse. He actually had Mickey Mouse in the cowling of his plane. Always smoking cigars. Mickey Mouse had a hatchet in one hand and a cigar in the other on his plane. He was quite a character.
Adolf Galland. Interesting guy. And they're going to cut their teeth in Spain. And that brings up the city of Guernica, where the Germans and Italians will bomb the city.
And you can see where this is going. Who else picks up on this? The United States. And in the later stages of 1938,
because of the Munich Agreement, Mr. Roosevelt will hold a meeting. He's convinced that the reason Hitler was able to get what he wanted at Munich was because of the superiority of the Luftwaffe.
He wants to double the amount of aircraft the United States produces.
All of a sudden now, he's not just Navy, air power. And Hap Arnold will leave that meeting, General of the United States Army Air Corps. And he's going to leave that meeting, and he was going to say, at last, we got our Magna Carta. Air power is going to take off in this country. And what's fascinating about this is,
in 1910, when you had Captain Benjamin Foloy from Washington, Connecticut, or Lieutenant Foloy at the time, flying the only Army plane and being the only Army pilot, by 1945, in 35 years, this country will go to an Army Air Forces of over 2,800,000 men and 80,000 aircraft, frontline aircraft. What happened here?
And the United States will focus on strategic air power because this is what these airmen want to do. Yes?
What happened? You haven't mentioned the Navy here.
Naval air power? Naval air power, yes, is, if you want to call it, taking off. And it's because of the aircraft carrier. You see this coming out of the First World War. Beginning there with seaplane carriers, where you can have a plane land in the water, crane will pick it up, put it on the seaplane carrier, or take the plane off the deck. But seaplane carriers are limited. No, but the aircraft carrier, having an actual aircraft land and take off from a flat top, that evolution and that technology, is it strategic? It's more tactical than strategic. You know, B-17, B-24 can take war a long way into an enemy's territory. The aircraft carrier can't do that. However, the aircraft carrier, when it comes along with the proper aircraft, you know, will take over from the battleship. It was at one point, the battleship was that vehicle for asserting sea power, because it extends ordnance or shoots a big gun as far as the eye can see.
But now you get an aircraft carrier with aircraft, you can now carry bombs or torpedoes beyond where the eye can see, and now the battleship is going to go into a secondary role. The aircraft carrier rises to the top. And that's happening.
Of course, when I get to NSA 47, about 5-10 minutes, you'll see where the Navy and the Air Force begin to squabble here.
However, having said that, yes, we're gonna produce a lot of, we're gonna produce over 12,000 B-17s in World War II and over 18,000 B-24s. Not counting B-29 jet.
It's over 3,000 of them. And so we are gonna join British Bomber Command in a concerted effort to bomb Nazi Germany. It's the most determined air campaign yet waged. And the reason I say that is because of the resistance posed by the Luftwaffe. Gonna lose a lot of planes here, folks. Gonna lose a lot of planes. Sir Hugh Harris, Sir Arthur Harris, Bomber Harris as he's known, he's gonna be given the job of British Bomber Command in 1942, January, February 1942. Keep in mind, Mr. Harris is one of those who flew missions against these villagers in the British colonies. He was dropping bombs on villagers. What he's going to do is, not to just keep villagers in line, he's gonna take what he did in these village, in these colonial backwaters, and apply it now to civilization, if you want to call it that. He comes up with a proposal of mass area bombing, night bombing. They tried bombing during the day and their losses were unacceptable. Keep in mind the British don't quite have our industrial production. But they are going to produce a lot of air. You know they're going to produce over about 20,000 Spitfires? So it's not like they can't produce, they can. So what he tries to convince the United States, once the United States is in the war, why are you going to pinpoint bombing for it doesn't work? The British did a study in 1941. They found that out of every 100 bombs they dropped, 3 got within 5 miles of the aiming point. That's embarrassing. You start hitting orphanages and hospitals. We'll go to night area bombing. And that's exactly what they're going to do. And he's going to put this idea into practice on May 30, 1942. They'll attack the German city of Cologne. He's going to scrape together every bomber he can find, and he's going to send 1,046 over in one night. The pattern is set for the rest of the war. Night area bombing. It's indiscriminate. It's absolutely horrifying. They would send the RAF would send pathfinders over with incendiaries. They'll find the city in question, just drop incendiaries, start the fires, and then the bombers will home in on the fires. That's basically how this works. And so as more bombers home in, what do you think happens with those fires? If you're looking at it from a 20,000 feet. You can't miss the city, all those fires going, and a firestorm is absolutely horrible. And so the United States, though, beginning in 1942, not having a lot of aircraft, will begin pinprick raids in France. We're not going into Germany yet, but they're setting the stage. We, by the way, will indulge in daylight bombing because we feel the B-17 can fight its way through as long as they stay in tight formations. I saw, if you've ever seen The World at War, remember that series narrated by Laurence Olivier when they interviewed Jimmy Stewart? Because Jimmy Stewart was a bomber pilot in World War II, you know, and he was talking about how this worked. Of course, when Jimmy Stewart talks, what should be about a 15-minute interview is 45 minutes. But he explains quite rightly what it was like. Maintain tight formations, and he said with the Norden bomb site, as long as you maintain a tight formation, a tight pattern on the ground can be achieved. And so that's what we are going to do, although we're eventually going to go into bombing the cities too, German cities too. But the idea here was to hit German industrial capacity. Mr. Harris, on the other hand, thought that, well, if I can dehouse 20% of German workers, German production will come to a halt. And we're eventually going to do the same thing in Japan, although area bomb Japan eventually too, once we bomb the factories. You go back to the night of March 8th, 1945, over 300 B-29s in a low-level attack at night will burn out the center of Tokyo. It's one of the most costliest raids in history. Anywhere from 100, they estimate anywhere from 120 to 140,000 Japanese died that night. Because many buildings in Japan are made of what?
Wood.
Yeah. So they burn quite well. They burn quite well.
Hamburg, Germany.
The British at night, Americans during the day, 9 days straight, bombing. Hamburg was bombed over 70 times during the war. Upwards of 50,000 people were killed in those raids.
And this is the pattern. And so you see what technology has done here. You go from Mr. Giulio Gavati in 1911 to what you're seeing now. It's astounding what you see, man's use of his technology.
However, does this strengthen the airman's hand for a separate service from the army? Yes. Air power is getting too sophisticated to be run by ground people. And yet the ground people complain that the Air Force doesn't pay much as much attention to ground support. The Army has its own artillery spotters. That's interesting how that is. The little L4 Piper Cub, which your family sedan goes faster than this thing. But the Army, to make sure they retain control of this, used to train artillery officers to be pilots and mechanics. Of course, the Cub only had a four-cylinder engine. If you were used to fixing your 36 Chevy in your backyard, you can fix a Cub. And the advantage of a Cub, they found this in training maneuvers here in 1941. They found that when a Cub was low on gasoline, you didn't need aviation fuel. So these guys would land, and if they were near a gas station, they would just... Or, if you were near somebody's farm and he wasn't looking, you took a hose out. Then they got back in your Cub, took off. And the plane only cost $2,000. The taxpayer got his money worth with that plane. Interesting what you're seeing here develop, that this divergence of the paths coming up here. And so with the atomic bomb now, the idea of using aircraft really takes off, because now you don't need 1,000 bombers to bomb a city. Maybe just a few with atomic bombs. You see what man again did with his technology here. However, you do have this massive economic or industrial capacity to produce weapons. Part of this is aircraft. You know, we're going to produce over 295,000 aircraft during the war. You know, the American aircraft industry is going to go from 43rd on the list of industries in this country in 1939, make $239 million. By 1944, the number one rated industry and make $16 billion. Air power, can't do without it. However, when the war is over with, what happens? The budget cuts again, mustering out people. And you're going to go from 16,112,000, mostly men in uniform, and they'll salvage maybe 1.2, 1.3 million when the war is over with. But seeing how the world has changed, again, the European colonial powers that started this war in 1914 do not win it. It's the United States and Soviet Union who do. The world has changed here. And now we have to refashion our military establishment to compete in this world. And so you get to 1947, the National Security Act of 1947. We are fashioning ourselves to be the dominant power of the world. One of the first things done is to separate air power from the army. And so you will have the United States Air Force. It's no longer the United States Army Air Forces. It's the United States Air Force. They will control the strategic bombing effort. They will control their fighter planes. They also want to take control of the tactical aspects of air power or supporting the ground troops. They even wanted to take away the artillery spotters from the Army. The Army was able to hold on to that. This gets into this what's going to be known as roles and missions discussions. And those discussions have been going on to this day. You know, whenever, in fact, I know when I was up at Army Aviation Magazine, I wrote an article for the magazine and I used close air support. And my boss says to me, "Do you know what you mean by that term?" I says, "I know exactly what I mean by that." He says, "Well, the Air Force isn't going to like it." I said, "The heck with them." You know, the Army likes to use things like tactical assets. You know, they like different terminology because close air support sounds like we're taking a role away from the Air Force. Well, the heck with them if they don't like a joke. But anyway, this has been going on, especially since the end of the war. The Army, you will now have a Department of the Army. There's no longer a War Department. Department of the Army. And now a Department of the Navy. Each has a commander officer. General of the Air Force, General of the Army, you know, Admiral of the Navy, right? And they will all be represented on the Joint Chiefs of Staff, which you now have. And they will give, what, military expertise to the president, right? Each service will have a secretary, a civilian. Secretary of the Air Force, Secretary of the Navy, Secretary of the Army. They will be the civilian leadership of these services. May, you know, recall that we like to keep civilian control over the military. How about the Marine Corps, though? Where do they sit? They will still be retained as part of the Department of the Navy. There will be a commanding general of the United States Marine Corps. He will also have a seat on the Joint Chiefs of Staff. That sounds like it gives the Navy more weight, doesn't it? Not really. The Navy is fearful. You know, the Navy has had this, we are the first line of defense because of our large Navy. And that goes back to when Teddy Roosevelt sent the Great White Fleet on the round the world cruise, announcing to the world that we are now a global power. You do that with naval power. You didn't have it. You know, the airplane would have been invented, but it really wasn't of any consequence here. The Navy was. And then again, the battleship, steel ships, somewhat new technology. Everyone's enamored with new technology. You know, the battleship is that epitome of the Industrial Revolution with regards to weaponry, able to send ordnance out to as far as the eye can see. And this ship was going through an evolution. The guns are getting bigger, the ship is getting bigger, the armor's getting thicker, and they're also going to go off from coal to oil. And that's going to accentuate, warships. Because now we're not on coal anymore, we're on oil. And you're going to get more miles out of a gallon of oil than you will out of a pound of coal. You don't have to refuel as often, and coaling's a dirty job. So again, technology is making it easier or more efficient to operate weapons of war. However, when the Second World War is over with, now modern bombers mated with the atomic bomb, that threatens the primacy of the Navy. Threatens the primacy of the Navy. Are we any longer the only, do we hold that mantle, first line of defense? They're afraid they're going to lose it. Now, the aircraft mated with the atomic bomb, would it be an expedient way of cutting the defense budget but still having a massive deterrent? Yeah. Of course, as long as we hold the monopoly on the bomb, and we know that's not going to last, because what do the Russians do in 1949? Explode their atomic bomb. But the Navy, to offset the Air Force, you know, they know that the Air Force still has many B-29s, and they're also going to come out with that new B-36 Peacemaker bomber, which has 6 prop engines and 4 jet engines to it. It's a huge plane. It's an absolutely huge plane carrying atomic bombs. The Navy, to stay in the game here, keep in mind, you're in competition for scarce budget dollars. All those billions that were spent in World War II,
Keep in mind, the defense budget, 1947 was only $14 billion. Wow, well, we need money. The Navy no longer wants these Essex-class carriers, 20, 22,000 tons, carrying Helldivers, Corsairs. I mean, those planes only weigh, what, 10,000, 11,000 pounds? No. They now want the 65,000-ton carrier United States that's over 1,000 feet long and will carry planes 30, 40,000 pounds apiece. Able to carry what? A nuclear bomb. They're not going to get it. They will later get the Forrestal. But this shows you how the United States is looking to refashion its defense establishment for the Cold War. But at the same time, you have the infighting going on between the services. Now add to this the Central Intelligence Agency. There is no more Office of Strategic Services anymore. We now have a set intelligence service known as the CIA. In addition to this, coming out of NSA 47, you now have the National Security Council, which is a conglomeration or committee of people who will advise the president on national security affairs. So now you have the Department of the Army, Department of the Navy, Department of the Air Force, the Marine Corps, and now you have the NSC and the CIA. So before in this country, when we would really cut the military, it seems like we're elaborating on the military at this point. Why? Because now we've taken our place on the world stage. This is what we've done here. You know, you can't remain with a citizen soldier concept that was prevalent around the time of the Revolution. You know, where guys 18 to 45 years old bought their own guns, bought their own shirts, their own pants, and the governors controlled the military effort for the most part. Now, you can't have that anymore. That's gone. Does that, going back to shooting now, does that change the meaning of the Second Amendment? Now, there's a discussion for you. Well-regulated militia. The right of the citizen to bear arms shall not be infringed. Well, that's you know, what follows is the 1792 Militia Act, where people bought their own guns. Coincides with the right of the citizen to bear arms. Well, now that the National Guard, which is all part of this evolution, is actually a bona fide reserve of the United States Army, and not really a well-regulated militia as originally intended, do we need a discussion here? Yeah, perhaps. Are there some who do not want that discussion? Perhaps. Korea. This new military formation will now be tried in Korea. And the Navy's going to be saved here, because you still need Navy power to get troops from point A to point B. And it's interesting what you're going to see here. The Navy will get that big aircraft carrier they were waiting for. The 70, not 65,000 tons, the 76,000 ton Forrestal. Able to carry aircraft such as the 47,300 pound Vigilante. So now the Navy will be able to be, have their atomic bomb potential. Why the Navy states, we are extremely mobile. There's still no bomber that can fly around the world. We can be although we have bases, we can be stationed in various areas of the world. Well, so can bombers for that matter. And so what you see coming out of the Korean War, though, because you did use the B-29 in Korea, but was it really an air campaign like against Germany? No. Is North Korea an industrialized state? No. But what you're going to see here give way after Korea is when Mr. Eisenhower takes office, he does not want us becoming a garrison state. No, we had to inflate the ground forces to fight the Korean War.
That's not what he wants. He comes out with something known as the New Look Defense. And one of the features of this will be massive retaliation. Keep in mind that B-36, that monstrosity, is going to be scrapped, and we're going to come up with the B-47 and the renowned B-52. And so when the war is over with, the Army will be cut from 20 divisions down to 14. The Navy will be cut about 100,000 men. The Air Force is the one that will advance an additional 30,000 men and go from 117 air wings to about 135, 137. And Mr. Eisenhower is going to go with the nuclear deterrent to maintain military primacy. It's interesting what you're seeing here. Interesting what you're seeing. Again, he's afraid of turning us into a garrison state. That's what he's afraid of. Now, this isn't World War II anymore. It's peacetime. And yet the day is coming when he's going to warn, when he's out of office, 1961, the military-industrial complex. That was built from between the First World War, when Bernard Baruch fashions the War Industries Board, organizing the American economy for war. Something alien to America, except for that hiccup known as the Civil War. And then the Second World War, where you really begin to see here the amalgamation of government and private industry with such things as the Defense Plant Corporation, where it's actually a taxpayer-funded corporation that will build factory space and lease it to big business. Well, big business, you know, Boeing's, of course, Boeing and Consolidated, so on and so forth. You are using here taxpayer dollars to create factory space for private business. So is that changing the economy? Yes, it is. But when you're fighting a conflict like World War II, don't you need to take all your assets and resources and organize them for that conflict, that global conflict? Yes, you do. Does it set a pattern, though? Yes, it does. Because when you get to Vietnam, it's interesting what you see here. Unlike World War II, where everyone was on the same page. If you weren't at the front, people were working in the factories, right? You know, unlike the early 30s when you were making maybe $25 a week for a family, you get to World War II, some of these people are making $200-$300 a week in the war plants. However, when meat is rationed, sugar is rationed, cheese is rationed, salt is rationed, can you spend all that money? No, you had to bank it. Helps finance the biggest post-war boom there ever was. At the same time, you've built this huge military-industrial complex. This huge industrial complex by itself. So when the war is over with, you got to put all these guys back to work. So now you have to prepare for building cars and trucks and washing machines and telephones, so on and so forth. And we're gonna supply the world until the world begins to catch up. Vietnam is an indication of this. And you're going to see in 1964. They're going to spend some $28 to $29 billion on weapons and supplies. By 1968, that will be up to $48-49 billion. And by 1969, we will be spending upwards of 48% of the federal budget on military equipment. And it will take up to 9.2% of the gross national product. And it's not a global conflict. So the stage is then set for after Vietnam, where you begin to see this thing called the military-industrial complex begin to take a life of its own. consolidation, and I'll get into this next week, but consolidation of this industry will occur. In fact, in 1982, when you measure the large plant, large businesses, and the small ones making just like one or two parts and then, you know, being subcontracted out to larger firms, you know, 138,000 factories involved, production facilities involved in this. In 6 years, there'll be only 40,000 left businesses because they eat up the small ones. In fact, during the Vietnam War, you can see where this is going. By 1968-1969, out of 435 congressional districts in this country, 363 are beholden to defense spending. Upwards of 5,000 communities are getting this defense largesse. It's interesting what you're seeing here, how it's transforming the economy. Obviously transforming your politics. You're going to get to that point. Do you honestly think your congressman and senator wants to cut that submarine base up in Groton? Look at it from that perspective. That's a base that's what, 635 acres? It's the oldest submarine base in the country, 1915. And yet, every time there's talks about, well, it's obsolete, let's cut it. What does the squawks go up? And yet, Kings Point, Georgia, the Navy base down there, is over 14,000 acres. They can also base submarines in Newport News. Why do they need that for? Political expediency? Jobs? That's a big one. Jobs. So it's fascinating here. Before even Pershing goes into the Mexico for that punitive expedition, not many people wanted a contract with the Army. They were late in paying or they didn't pay. Now everybody and his uncle wants a contract with the Army. It's fascinating how this turn of events has transpired. Absolutely fascinating. But when you go back to National Security Act 1947, you see here this refashioning of not only the defense establishment, national security, it's becoming more and more and more important to the point where what George Washington warned against in his farewell address, entangling alliances, the UN is a fine thing, but there is Article 43. Where we are obligated to take our place with other UN members if the need arises to send troops. However, it was supposed to be fashioned to the point where the president would have to report to Congress, you know, we're going to have to send so many troops for so much amount of time. Okay, well then, you know, this idea of the president going before Congress to ask for a declaration of war, okay, we'll overcome that and abide by Article 43. Now, the problem here, and they were supposed to report back, what's going on? Do you need more men? Are men coming home? Do we need more equipment? No, Truman bypassed Article 43. Okay, we're just sending the men there. Congress wasn't even really consulted here. I mean, he consulted with Congress, but nothing happens. We just sent troops to Korea. Why? We are now involved in the Cold War struggle. And that kind of goes back to what I heard 3 weeks ago at a Democracy for America meeting over in Norwalk when Himes was there running for re-election, said he was quite disappointed that Mr. Obama did not, I repeat, did not truly consult with Congress before getting us involved with the Europeans in Libya. Now that's tall coming from a Democratic congressman talking about a sitting Democratic president here who he supports. So if we're going to bypass the Constitution, and now we're bypassing the War Powers Act, what happened to Congress? Interesting what you're seeing here. It's absolutely fascinating what you're seeing develop in this country with regards to this. To the point where, interesting, in 1995 to 1997, there was some $142 billion worth of arms sold in the world. Out of $142 billion, we took over $77 billion of that.
and a lot of this talk about fearing Russia. You know how much of that $142 billion the Russians got or sold on the world markets in those 3 years? $9.2 billion. Yes?
Another factoid is that we spend more than the next 15 countries combined in terms of spending, yet some politicians are talking about our decimated military and increasing the spending.
Well, and you're going to hear, in fact, you bring up a great point here, and that's a notable point. In fact, I don't know how many of you stumbled on this, but I did about 2 weeks ago. A defense analyst with accounting came up with and you're going to hear this again next week. But between now and next week, I'm going to try to do some more research on this because this is coming out. Interesting, it's coming out now. You know, the election's next week. And apparently, you can call this anything you want, accounting oversight, or sloppy accounting methods. The Army can't find or is trying to look into what happened to not 6.5 million, not 6.5 billion, $6.5 trillion.
Isn't that one third of our total debt?
Yeah.
Talk about creative accounting.
Well, it's astounding, and since this just came out, I'm trying to get more information on it so I can maybe prepare a little better for next week. But this is just coming out. I find that amazing because if you go back to I'm getting into next week, but it should be said now. 1990. The Chief Financial Officers Act, passed by Congress, where every major branch of the federal government had to do an audit and report to Congress, right? Guess which branch has not done this audit in 26 years?
Trump.
Defense Department. And if you notice here, folks, none of your presidential candidates will touch the military-industrial complex, and that includes Sanders. Who's the only, we'll call her a major candidate, who's the only one who will talk about it?
Jill Stein.
The only one, which is probably why she's polling only 3-4%. You know, they're not going to let her on those debates. Whoa, that'll be the last person they want. Interesting what you're seeing here. Absolutely fast. How do you lose $6.5 trillion? Or I'll put it this way. How can you lack the accounting procedures for $6.5 trillion? Like I said, between now and next Monday, I'm going to try to do what I can to get more information on this. I mean, this is astounding, although I'm not surprised. In fact, I'm going to ask my boss because he's out of town. When I go in the office, if he's back, no, he's not. He's not coming back till Thursday. Darn it! I'm going to ask him. Hey, Bill, you rub elbows with these guys. What happened to that money? Interesting. It's fascinating. I find this whole concept fascinating. Now, again, many businesses didn't want to do business with the Army prior to the punitive expedition. Now the Army can't find $6.5 trillion in 100 years? It's amazing. And yet, you know, it should be, and you know, I'm a big booster of this. You can't look disparagingly on the privates, the corporals, and the sergeants. It's the higher-ups. Because when we talk about the military, oh, Christmas, the military, you know, who is the one, who's the poster child expression of this on the local level? It's the private, the corporals, and the sergeants. You know, look beyond them. These people don't do this. It's astounding. Yes?
So I asked Kimes the very question that you just had.
Oh, you did?
And I said, look, you're our representative. And, you know, as citizens, we can all ask what we want him to do.
Right.
And you're a representative, yet Connecticut has some very big ticket military spending. Mm-hmm. A lot of people talk about government debt and all that kind of stuff. Well, Pratt & Whitney and the
Sikorsky,
F-35, right. Sikorsky, the electric boat, big, big numbers.
Right.
If you want to cut government spending, it's one of the places you gotta go. But what do you want our representative to do? Do we really need another nuclear submarine?
The Ohio class?
Or do we put thousands of people out of work in New London?
Well.
And it's, the system doesn't work right.
Correct.
You know, and he admitted, he said, that's a very, very tough question that they.
It is.
That they have.
It is.
He says, here I am a representative, what do you want me to do? He kind of handed it back to me.
Right.
Tough call.
It is a tough call because, you know, as defense spending has spread or leached into many areas of the country, and with now us losing our lead in the auto industry, washers, dryers, computers, what do we have?
GE had the backup engine to the F-35, which the military said, we don't want a backup engine.
Mm-hmm.
Yet, all, you know, these supposed fiscal conservatives says, oh, yes, you do.
And, yeah.
You know, there's this multi-billion dollar backup engine to a plane that's questionable whether we need that at all.
Yeah. It's fascinating what you see going on here. Ominous, but it's fascinating. And what I do applaud here, getting off of things like military spending, is what you're seeing on the grassroots level. You're seeing in some places like in Ohio that have been savagely hit, you know, with the decline of the auto industry, these worker co-ops starting up. I mean, we've always had those, but you're seeing people now beginning to band together to open up, you know, companies and works together to try to resurrect the American worker and the civilian side of the economy. It's interesting what you're seeing develop on the grassroots level. But, you know, I mean, things like the auto industry have been savaged. And I always found it amazing that, you know, at its heyday, the auto industry, between their hourly wage and their benefits.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I read somewhere where General Motors, it was costing them per worker because of the health aspects, the health and welfare benefits, $7,000 a year per worker. And so when they began to open up in Canada, some plants in Canada, because of the universal health care they have in Canada, that cost went from $7,000 per year to $1,000. Why not go to Canada, right?
That would include retirees.
Mm-hmm.
Active people, and it would include retirees.
But it's interesting here. The accounting procedures here. It's fascinating.
If you start over, you don't have retirees.
That's correct. So it's interesting. But with defense, that's a different story. Although parts are still offshore, you know, some aspects are offshore too here. But it's fascinating what you're seeing develop in this country. Absolutely fascinating. And again, you read the papers. You know, a lot of equipment going to Saudi Arabia now for Yemen. Bombing in Yemen. Interesting. Absolutely fascinating. And yet, there's the downside of this. When we rebuilt the Iraqi army as we were leaving, and what happened with the Islamic State? When all those, when the Iraqi army melted like a snowball in the spring, all the equipment, right? 2,500 Humvees alone. Wow. Yes.
Well, as a new portion of defense spending, they're doing upgrade kits, like for the old M60s tanks,
mm-hmm.
so the defense sector is saying, well, they're using our old aircraft, F-22s, and this, why don't we just upgrade? They still work. The A-10s, they still work. So now we see upgrade kits being produced left and right.
Well, that A-10 Warthog that the Air Force had, that ground support plane, the Air Force really didn't want that. And the only reason they're going to get it is because the Army, and during the Vietnam War, you know, the Huey helicopter comes out, and that's virtually a transport helicopter. That's to move people from point A to point B, or supplies, right? But when you need a true attack helicopter, they begin to load this thing up. with weapons, and it slows down. Well, what happens when it slows down? It's easier to shoot down. Now the Bell comes out with the Cobra. But at the same time, there was work going on a new helicopter called the Cheyenne. And that would have changed everything, and the Air Force stepped in and said, no. If you're gonna have a true ground support air, again, here we go, close air support, they come out with the A-10. Not because the Air Force wanted to, because they knew they had to stay in the game. And that's a darn good plane. Every time the Air Force wants to get rid of it, it seems to come back here. It's not the fastest plane in the world, it's a ground support plane. You know, so it's interesting because the Air Force always thought, well, you can take a fighter plane and use that for ground support. They did that in World War II with the P-47 Thunderbolt. That was the difference between us and the Russians. The Russians had a plane called the IL-2 Shtermovik. And Eddie Rickenbacker went to the Soviet Union. He saw this thing. He says, this is the best plane of its type in the world. It's the most mass-produced combat plane in history at 36,163 copies. It had an undered armor side to it, so it was harder to shoot down. In fact, German anti-aircraft gunners, eyewitness accounts, 20-millimeter cannon, shell would hit the bottom of Shtermovik and break up. That wasn't happening with any other plane. And Stalin once said that the Red Army needs the Shtermovik as much as it needs air to breathe. And when the Soviet Army mates that plane up with the T-34 tank, wow, holy Christmas. But the United States Army Air Force didn't want to do that. So we used to use P-47 Thunderbolts for ground support, but it was basically a fighter. And why? Philosophy. If we start making ground support planes, we might lose that effort to become a separate air force because of strategic aviation, and we don't want any part of that. And so, it proceeds the way it does. But the Soviets, again, weren't interested in strategic aviation. Their air force was geared toward the Soviet Army. Now, if the Americans and British want to take up the strategic bombing campaign, let them. We know what we got to do. Different philosophy. But it produces certain weapons per that philosophy. Yes?
So thinking ahead, and maybe we're in transition now, when you think about cyber warfare, both offensive and defensive.
Yeah, we haven't even touched that yet.
I mean, that may very well, just following your logic here, become a separate branch of the state.
Well, you no longer have the Industrial Revolution. It's what now, the technology revolution? Is cyber warfare part of a technology revolution? I would say so. I mean, where are we going with this? God only knows at this point. God only knows. And the potential here, unlimited. Well, going back to these emails and stuff. I mean, let's throw that in there. And I'm not even going to touch these things with Comey right now because we don't really know. We don't know everything we need to know. Of course, some people are going to make political hay out of this. I understand that. But, you know. Yes, ma'am?
Doesn't cyber warfare really have an intelligence function?
It sure does.
That's really what the emphasis is with the cyber warfare, or the cyber command, or whatever you want to call it. And what we're seeing right now with this hacking of emails is nothing but a preliminary action that indicates where we're going as far as technology goes.
Bouncing off what you just said, I was supposed to go to Edgewood and Stanford. I'm supposed to go down there soon to give a talk down there. In fact, I go there every so often. I do a lot of assisted living facilities too. And the lady apologized for not returning my email. This was last week. And I said, that's quite all right, Mary. I said, you know, I mean, we got time yet. She says, no, I want to put this to bed, or I want to put this to bed now. I said, that's fine. And apparently, all the benchmark that they own, that's the company that owns the Edgewood assisted living facility, all the Benchwood facilities up and down the East Coast were out. And if you saw what happened the Friday before last, they got the East Coast
and going around the southwest, southeast area of the United States got hacked. They were up fairly soon, but they all got hacked. Now, going by what you're saying here, interesting. Instead of using bombers to attack an industrial infrastructure, you're using a computer hack to attack the electronic infrastructure.
I say this all the time. Everybody must realize that anything can be hacked. That's one of the reasons I designed my income tax to get a refund. I'm never going to send a check to the government because that can be hacked. So I designed it to get a refund.
Yeah, I mean, it's...
You know, if somebody wants to hack it and steal my refund of, it's usually $50, $60, $70, $100, maybe $150. If somebody wants to hack that and steal it, I don't care.
Well, you know what, though? If they do that 200 times...
Well, yeah, but I'm just one person.
Right.
Yeah.
But if you know what you're doing, and you can do that, I got $20 here, I got $50 here.
I used to be in information technology, so.
All right.
But I tell everybody, and I tell everybody in this room, anything can be hacked.
Yeah.
Anything you put in an email can be revealed.
Right.
Well, I think that's what's going on right now.
Yeah, well, I agree with you because I think you know what you're saying here is going to lead to after these elections. What are these politicians going to do to eliminate these embarrassing moments here?
Well, I think they stand forward.
They can't.
Now.
Yeah.
They can't.
I mean, I don't think Donald Trump has had any emails that are worth being hacked. Won't even reveal his income tax. Now there's something that ought to be
hacked.
Well,
they came out with it. Didn't
pay
anything for 18
years. Well, yeah.
But the danger here is the air traffic control system.
Yeah.
Correct.
Stock exchanges.
Right.
Et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
I mean, the country would come to a stop.
Right.
And
or the grid.
Or the electric power grid and all
power
that.
Power grid first.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't have to tell you if that ever got attacked. Americans, I'm sure you know some people. Oh God, without electricity, oh my God, what are we going to do now? Well, get out a candle for the.
We got to drive around with the Niagara thing.
Right. Yeah. Well, get out candles at the first order of business here. You know. So, you are open to this, like you say.
Because the Russians are hacking the email systems. That certainly is. In the
Chinese?
Yeah. And the other mistake that's been made is the outsourcing of all of our IT work to any place in the world.
Right.
It's asking for trouble.
Yeah.
The work that's going on in India and Poland and all sorts of places where we're just blissfully sending it off, outsourcing it, would ought to be staying right here in this country.
To me, that's a national security priority, doing it that way.
It's yet to be revealed. And we're just getting it in a minor way now because the Russians are hacking our election.
Right.
Or hacking an email.
Well, I would.
There's so much at stake here, it boggles my mind.
I would broaden that a bit. I would broaden that concept a bit because we're being. We're being told the Russians are hacking us.
Yeah.
Let's use different words. Wow. Everybody is hacking everybody. Mm-hmm. What do you think we're doing to Iran? What do you think we're doing to China? What do you think we're doing to Serbia? This is universal.
Well, I hope
I'd like to bring the conversation back to the military-industrial complex and our role as the world's policeman and what it's doing to us from a cost basis. We are addicted to the military-industrial complex.
Right.
How do we get a treatment facility for us is my broad question.
Well, I'm going to go into that more deeply next week when I talk about the permanence of the military,
yeah.
Because that's what you're asking here,
the
permanence of the military-industrial complex. And again, go back to what I mentioned earlier, are any of these presidential candidates talking about this? No, of course not. They don't want to touch this with a 10-foot pole. But at the same time, how come the Army can't find $6.5 trillion? Now, that didn't happen 1 year. That's over a period of years, obviously, here.
How much much of the space program would be included in this $6.5 trillion?
No, with the Army, probably not that, hardly anything at all.
Yeah, but that's all under the control of NASA. And who actually, is there a military entity that controls NASA, or is that?
Well, a lot of that would be the Air Force.
The Air Force. Well,
right.
Possibly part of that 6.5 is the space program, because that's a costly program.
Well, this was supposed to be just the Army. This is just the Army, not the Navy or the Air Force, just the Army. Which goes into your, I'm sure you've heard this before, the $500 hammers, the $600 toilet seats, that kind of thing, right? And so, you know, if you buy a hammer for $29.95, well, what happened to the other $470 here? Well, it goes into secret projects, or whatever the case may be, or it gets lost along the way.
Yeah,
well, and so, is that sloppy accounting procedures, or is that creative accounting?
Well, the cost of other programs is being distributed over those items that you just mentioned.
Correct. And so yes, this does get into the permanence of the military-industrial complex. Again, where I said before, where, you know, prior to the punitive expedition in Mexico, who the heck wanted a contract with the Army? But after World War II, there's money to be made here. And since there's money to be made here, will there eventually be a consolidation? Sure. I mean, you had over 40 aircraft companies during the Second World War. They're all gone. Douglas, you know, standalone companies, Douglas, Fairchild, they're all consolidated. They're all gone.
Yeah, but don't you think the shift that we're witnessing right now is getting away from those corporations that build goods, like airplanes and submarines, et cetera, to those corporations that deal with information technology?
Well, I think the question you have to ask here, yes, is, you know, the military implications of information technology are limitless at this point.
But that's the shift that's going on right now.
Correct.
And
right.
Not many people are aware of it.
Well, I don't think people pay much attention to it at this stage. But you will. You'll see more. Well, yeah, there is more and more people paying attention to it. I'm hearing this when I go to these different talks.
You start following a few stocks and you begin to see the ones that are kind of creeping up, like Cisco. Or any cloud-based company.
Mm-hmm. Well, look at AT&T as an example. Look at AT&T. What did they do? They sold off to Frontier landlines and that kind of thing. They don't want to be involved in it anymore.
Right. What company was that?
AT&T. Right. You know, so if you have Frontier, you were at one point an AT&T customer.
Oh, well, that's another thing. That's entertainment.
Right, that is, but at the same time, it's still an example of where some of these companies want to go. And so, yeah, I mean, what you're again, this is no longer the Industrial Revolution, it's the Technology Revolution.
Speaking of AT&T, they run a huge part of the nation's communication infrastructure, even if other people put their name on it. Mm-hmm. And also, AT&T was very cooperative with NSA and all that snooping business.
Well, so is Verizon.
Yeah.
You see, the other aspects of what you're saying here, and again, this gets back to the military-industrial complex, monopoly. You can't have a monopoly without what? Government collusion, really.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, go back to Kennedy, John F. Kennedy. Didn't he protect AT&T's primacy with satellite technology? Communications? Yeah, he did.
Yeah, that's right.
So it's interesting what you see here.
It's
fascinating.
The transfer of information to China about 20 years ago with a satellite.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So it's interesting what you see here. But when we come back next week, I'm going to discuss the permanence of the military-industrial complex. That goes back to the question you were asking before. And that's basically what this is, the permanence of the military-industrial complex. And you can tell this permanence when your candidates don't want to touch it. They don't want to touch it.
Well, maybe they don't understand it.
That sounds more like that.
Well,
ultimately, the fault goes back to the Congress.
Well, Congress is supposed to...
persons that want the little plant in their district.
Correct. Well, go back to what I mentioned 15 minutes ago. During the Vietnam War, you know, as you're getting deeper into the war, you're finding out of 435 congressional districts, 363 are getting defense dollars. That's a lot.
Yeah.
That's a lot.
Sure. and that's your Congress too.
Right. So, you know, what happened to Congress as your firewall, as the caretaker of the purse?
It's not a firewall.
Well, then perhaps that accounts in part to why Congress has an approval rating south of 10%.
No, that's because the corruption lies in the Congress.
Well, of course.
It really upsets me when they call Hillary Clinton corrupt. Congress is corrupt.
Of course. But, I mean, that's one of the reasons they won't touch the military-industrial complex. You're seeing that's part of the corruption, too. But again, when I come back next week, and what I'm going to try to do is before next Monday, I'm going to try to find out more about that $6.5 trillion. That just amazes me here. I mean, how many zeros can we add to this?
That should be the homework assignment. We've all got to come back with an entity that's contributed to the $6.5 trillion.
It's fascinating. Absolutely fascinating.
I'll do my best to find one.
Beg your pardon?
I'll do my best to find one. Just contributed to the $6.5 trillion.
Do so. Otherwise, folks, have a happy Halloween.